think back to when I first started playing in bands, I mean, it was very natural for me to want to play like heavy music and very mellow music. And, you know, all my heavy metal friends couldn't understand, and all the girls that I knew thought I wrote these pretty songs. And it was probably one of those things, like, it's what I did naturally and then kind of figured it out after the fact. And I wouldn't necessarily attribute it to masculine or feminine, just more so as just like expressing everything that I am, you know, as opposed to trying to uphold some kind of retarded ancient medieval machismo that doesn't really exist in anyone that I know. And that goes to all you death metal bands. Our demographic, or whatever you want to call it, is pretty wide. I think we go pretty much from like, you know, 10 to 40. And I meet plenty of adults who really like what we do and find that it still connects with what they liked about rock music when they were younger, but it has a certain amount of maturity where they don't feel it's dealing with issues that they cannot relate to. So, and whatever, I don't care. I mean, I always, you know, I like old music, I like new music, and if anybody likes music, they should like it if it's good, and not like it if it's bad. I don't know, I think those kind of generational gaps and the gaps in between musical styles are really getting smaller and smaller. Post, you know, the grunge explosion, everybody jumped on the, oh, I was in the punk rock bandwagon. And so suddenly we're getting asked all these questions of what we think about punk rock. And so as usual, we told the truth and we said we never liked punk rock. And they said, well, what'd you like? And I said, well, we grew up on typical 70s radio in America, which was Boston Cheap Trick. And so if we picked a mold, we picked the mold more so of your traditional rocking band that did lots of different material and covered lots of different bases. But it's not like we sit around and go, oh man, we want to make an album just like
Budokan.
Live at Budokan. Yeah, we sit around and try and figure out how we need to top ourselves. Shut up, Jimmy. If I had my preference, I'd prefer that people would just listen to the music and make judgments on that. But we're not just competing on a musical level, we're competing it with media too. You know, and to pretend that it's not a world driven through media and through perception would be stupid. You know, so you have to, you know, you can try and pretend that there's not a media machine that you have to feed into, but you know, that's lying. You know that. You know you have to deal with, you know, the MTVs and the Melody Makers and the enemies and all that of the world. So, you know, you make a choice to decide how you want to be in those mediums. And my choice personally has been be who I am. And if it's misinterpreted, then there's nothing I can do about that. But if I'm trying to outguess some idiot, you know, who's never been on stage, never played a note in his life, you know, and I'm not excluding some women from this, you know, who cannot understand, you know, the depth of what we do, then that's their problem, but it's not my problem because they can't understand. Yeah. Smashing Pumpkins are concerned, the reason we get put in a lot of magazines and things is because we help sell the magazines, and we get this kind of begrudging press in a lot of cases where they don't really want to put us in there, but when they put us on the cover or they put us in the magazine, it sells partially because we're involved. So, you know, my feeling about it is we've gotten a lot written about us because we write really good music. And we have pretty dedicated fan base who supports the band in that way too. Album, we opted to talk about some of the difficulties that we'd had because we were already through them pretty much, so it wasn't such a big deal for us to talk about them. And you know, for the first month it was interesting, and then every interview after that, all we do was get asked about the things that we'd said the first month after the album came out, and so then it just becomes a self-perpetuating myth. Dysfunctional tension creates better music. I think the dysfunctional tension has only prevented us from making the music that we're capable of making. Wouldn't you agree?
No, absolutely. I mean, the record sounds the way it does because it was dysfunctional, but I don't think we're incapable of making great music, you know, when we're getting along. I mean, that's pretty stupid.
We're getting along just fine now, and we're writing more songs than ever, so, and we're happy with what we're doing. Let me out. the other notion that I enjoy being a twisted neurotic person is ridiculous, you know. I mean, I'm a twisted neurotic person because my parents didn't assume the responsibilities that they supposedly had when they had me, so, you know, that's what I'm dealing with, so whatever, you know. Again, it gets back into myth, you know. I mean, people think somehow I enjoy being this, you know, uncomfortable persona. I don't, you know. I've never fit in, and I've never fit in because of the person I am or I'm not or whatever, but, you know, deep down inside, I wished I'd just been a normal, stupid kid like most people are. I'm dreadfully afraid of, like, a lack of desire. That's the thing that terrifies me more than anything. Like, wanting, you know, getting out of bed and not wanting to do anything anymore. And I go through periods of that, but somehow I've always found the energy to still want to really work hard on the band and work hard on music. So that's the thing that terrifies me most. You know, it's like, I think, you know, can I be rocking at 35? You know? I don't know. I mean, we were just listening to the new Cheap Trick record upstairs, and they're rocking pretty good for however old they are. I don't know, so whatever. The reason I wrote Disarm was because I didn't have the guts to kill my parents, so I thought I'd get back at them through song. And rather than write an angry, violent song, I thought I'd write something beautiful and make them realize what tender feelings I have in my heart and make them feel really bad for treating me like shit.
Do you think it worked?
Yeah, it's my mother's favorite song in the album. My original idea was, and this is what I told Jake Scott, was I wanted the band to be playing in the sky. I didn't want any place, you know, like here they are in the corner, here they are in Spain. So he came up with the idea of this kind of like fairy tale-esque, you know, where things were, like how a child would see fairy tale things, like things are bigger and smaller, they're not all in scale. So he took my original conception and the look that I wanted and turned it into that. So, for the first time ever, like, a video director actually understood the language that I was speaking in it, and it worked out pretty nice. Mm-hmm. There's just too much pressure sometimes to come up with the, you know, the video of the ages. And I'm just starting to feel that we should apply the same aesthetic to videos that we apply to the records we make. And it's unfortunate because we're not video directors, so it's not the easiest thing to do. People constantly question who we are, why we are, and it's like, it's because of what, this is how we are all the time. And people can't not get through that through their fucking skull. This is how we are, and that's what we, what walks on stage is really how we are. And people go, oh, come on, really, what's the trick here? Like there's some secret game we play with everybody. That's all.